Christ each day, a faithful Christian said. And I replied, I drive a truck and I fill the stores with bread. He said, I know of your bread route, but that is not the thing. I mean, what do you do each day for Jesus Christ the King? I said, but I believe a man can work in such a way that selling bread is a way and a work for Christ, a sacrament each day. Once more, the man inquired, but sir, if this is not unfair, what do you do for Christ each day, like witnessing and prayer? I said, work is my best witness, and selling bread to them is like a prayer in Jesus' name. I drive the truck for him. I agree that this truck driver was making a positive impact for the Lord each day. We can live our lives in such a way that we make an impact on others around us, not only through our worship, but through our ordinary work each day. The Bible says God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and he went around doing good because God was with him. Sometimes it seems difficult to connect our faith with our daily life. And so today, on this day of Labor Day, I ask you, what do you do in your life each day and in your work to praise Jesus? As I thought about this story, I started thinking about my childhood and growing up in the church. And although today we're not having communion because Pastor Janet is gone, I thought about communion. I had a very special friend in our congregation named Elizabeth Dial. And she was, well, at that time I probably thought she was 96. But to be honest, she was probably in her 70s growing up when I was younger. And every Sunday that we had communion, she was in charge of baking the bread. And she had the most beautiful round loaves of bread I'd ever seen. They were just huge. And she would bring them each Sunday. But Elizabeth was blind. So for me, being a young teenager, the thought of making a loaf of bread for the entire congregation, not just family, to eat and to enjoy, for something as special as communion, was kind of intimidating. But for Elizabeth, who was blind and retired and looking at ways to serve her God, baking that bread was her sacrament to God. The really neat piece of Elizabeth with her bread was she always did a trademark Elizabeth thing with the bread. See, she also knew that there were lots of children at communion time. And she knew that children love bread. Maybe they don't quite get the grasp of the grape juice and the bread and why we take communion. But she knew that when that bread was on that altar, mouths would start watering and the kids would wonder when they would get a piece. I can remember even after communion being over, my mom was director of Christian education in our church, I had the luxury of going through after communion and drinking all of the grape juice and eating all of the bread. That was my favorite part of communion. So each month when we do communion, that's a memory I hold close. But Elizabeth's bread, every Sunday that she did communion, had a smiley face made out of bread. So if you can imagine our parents trying to teach us to take communion very seriously and remember to ask God to forgive our sins and to be polite and to put your hand out and don't rush to throw it in your mouth and make sure you dip it. If you can imagine all of us children lining up, going up to the bread and seeing a big smiley face on that bread. That's what it's about. That's exactly the message I'm trying to say to you all today. Is that living our life, no matter what we do, whether we're a homemaker, or a banker, or a teacher, or a sanitation worker, God is telling us that we have been instructed to be a witness to Him, for Him. It doesn't matter how much we make or how little we make. It doesn't matter how much we don't think we're making an impact on someone's life. How often do you walk down the street when you meet people and look them in the eye? Those of you that know me well know that I don't know too many strangers. In fact, just last week I was traveling to Pratt, Kansas, and I stopped about 6:30 in the morning at a McDonald's. And my parents and my family and my cousins will tell you, I take after my grandpa. My grandpa's a truck driver. And they say that I can talk to anybody, even when I'm not trying. So I walk into the McDonald's, and there seated is a man who I'm pretty sure is a truck driver, kind of sitting by himself, reading the paper. He looks up to me, I look at him, and instead of looking away, I say, "Good morning, how are you?" And he puts down his paper and he says, "I'm doing great, how are you?" And I turned around and I proceeded to tell him I was doing good. And instead of turning back around to go place my order, he continues to talk. Pretty soon, another man comes up who was sitting by himself in the other corner. Keep in mind, I was just trying to go in. I didn't go through the drive-thru because I had a trailer with me, but I was just trying to go in and go out. Pretty soon, another man sees me. He's sitting by himself in the corner. I kind of noticed him at first. He looked a little sad and lonely. He comes up. He sits down at the same table with the guy and says, "Good morning, ma'am. How are you?" And again, I say, "I'm doing great. How are you?" And he proceeds to tell me about his day. Truth be told, my 5-minute stop for food kind of turned into a 25-minute stop, which kind of put me a little behind for the rest of my day. But it put a smile on my face that entire day. You see, the reality is that all of us are on this earth kind of looking for the same thing. We're looking for ways to be in relationship with one another. We're looking for ways to be accepted. We're looking for a connection to other people. We're looking for God, whether it's in this church or outside of these walls. What is it that you do in your life? Do you ever have days where you feel your life doesn't make a difference? In an interview with Mother Teresa of Calcutta, India, a woman who gave her life to feed starving people and minister to the dying, the person conducting the interview asked Mother Teresa about her feelings of being used of God to minister to the poor. Her little work was known worldwide. Even the president of the USA knew her and her labor of love. She answered, "But it is His work. I think God wants to show His greatness by using my nothingness." She was asked later, "You feel you have no special qualities?" Mother Teresa replied, "I don't think so. I don't claim anything of the work. It is His work, and I am like a little pencil in His hand. That is all. He does the thinking, He does the writing. The pencil has nothing to do with it. The pencil has only to be allowed to be used." Mother Teresa. Some of you that are younger may not know who Mother Teresa is, though I hope you learn about her in school. But for her to think that she was using her nothingness, and she devoted her entire life living among the poor, feeding the hungry, helping the sick, reaching out to those who we see on the street and we may want to walk by. What if we were to think of our life just as Mother Teresa, like a little pencil in His hand? He does the thinking, He does the writing. The pencil has nothing to do with it. The pencil has only to be allowed to be used. I have to admit that this sermon comes at a really good time for me, because in my personal life right now, I'm feeling a little overwhelmed. Had a lot of things going on medically in my family and feeling stressed out with work, with mine, my husband's. And sometimes you have to stop and you have to wonder, God, am I still doing what you called me to do? What am I doing? And am I doing it for you? Just like the bread man who's on his route and looks at his life as his way of giving a sacrifice to God, we are called to do the same thing. When you go to work tomorrow morning or Tuesday, smile at the person who's at security. Think about the policeman on the street. Think about all those who have an impact on our life that we sometimes forget about. Can you imagine what it would be like if we woke up on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, week after week, and realized that our sanitation workers not only took the day off to catch up, but they take a week off? Sometimes in our mind, we have a tendency to forget about those. And though we could be quick to judge that Sunday is a day to take a rest, the reality is that our life is a little bit more busier than that. Taking a look at Genesis chapter 29, or chapter 1, verse 29, God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life. I have given every green plant for food," and it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning the sixth day. Then the heavens and the earth were finished in all of their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day, and he hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. But as we go a little bit further, and I won't keep reading, we see chapter 15, or verse 15. Chapter 2, verse 15. "The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You may freely eat of every fruit of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day you eat of it, you shall die.'" We're reminded that from the very beginning, God did plan for us to work. He didn't plan for us to have a day on the seventh day, every single day. He did ask us to do his work. But we have come a long ways in our society, where in the beginning we worked for paying the bills, or not paying the bills, we worked for the garden, that we would have food and housing and those things. And it has become to the point now where sometimes we get so lost in what society agrees is a need and a want. We're always wanting the better house, the better car, the more money, the vacations, the extravagance. But sometimes we just need to remember what it is we're on this roller coaster for. That no matter what you're going through right now, maybe you're working really hard and you're not sure that you are where God planted. Or maybe you're struggling to find a job. Or maybe you're dealing with negative people in your life that you just don't know how to battle that with compassion, care, and grace. Maybe if we stop for a moment and we remember that all of those things don't matter. When the time has come for us to go to heaven, it won't matter what car we drove, what coworker we pleased, what house we lived in. It will only matter the grace that we show other people by loving one another and accepting God. As you leave here today, I challenge each of you to think and say thanks for those people in your lives who have made a difference. As I talked to the kids, Think about the farmers who are out in the field today. Think about the policemen who are out in the workforce. And gosh knows that our society right now needs a lot of prayers. There's a lot of violence, and there's a lot of fear. And getting my cousin and I were talking about this last night. Her husband is a police officer. And every time they get in the car, they are seriously wondering if this could be the day that someone comes up and has an act of violence on each of them. There are people in our lives who do things day in and day out with no gratitude. As you go out to eat today, don't think about the person who's not sitting in church but instead working. Think about the single mom who has three kids at home and is working a job that doesn't even pay the bills just so her kids will have lunch on Monday morning. Think about ways that we can expand on not the negatives of God's message, but the positives. Love one another as God loved each one of us. An American investment banker who took a vacation to a small coastal village in Mexico. He was walking on the pier one evening when a fisherman in a small boat came in to dock. In his boat were several nice, large, yellowfin tuna. The American complimented the quality of the fish and asked the fisherman how long it took to catch them. The fisherman replied, "Only a little while." The American then asked, "Why don't you stay out longer and catch more? I have enough fish to support my family's immediate needs. But what do you do with the rest of your time?" The fisherman said, "I sleep late, fish a little, play with my children, take siesta with my wife, and stroll into the village each evening where I sip wine and play guitar with my amigos. I have a full and busy life." The American scoffed, "Huh. I am a Harvard MBA, and I can help you. You should spend more time fishing, and with the proceeds, buy a bigger boat." The fisherman asked, "Why do I need a bigger boat?" And the American replied, "You could catch even more fish, and then buy another boat, and another. Eventually, you could have a fleet of fishing boats. Instead of selling your catch to a middleman, you would sell directly to the processor. Eventually opening your own cannery. You would control the product, processing, and the distribution. You would need to leave the small coastal fishing village and move to Mexico, then LA, and eventually New York City, where you will run your expanding enterprise." The fisherman asked, "But how long will all this take?" To which the American replied, 15 to 20 years. "But what then?" The American laughed and said, "Well, that's the best part. When the time is right, you would announce an IPO, sell your company stock to the public, and become very rich. You would make millions." "Millions? What then?" "Why, then you would retire. Move to a small coastal fishing village where you would sleep late, fish a little, play with your grandkids, take siesta with your wife, and stroll to the village in the evenings where you could sip wine and play your guitar with your amigos." Do what you will with this story, but it reminds us to take everything in perspective. As we leave here today, may you take a moment to evaluate where you are with your life. Give appreciation for the job that God or whoever has provided for you. Take time to thank those who are in service to each of us. But to remember, your true job is to spread the love and grace of God to all people. May we do so with open hearts, open minds, and smiles on our faces. Amen.